Hey everyone, welcome to Ian and Friends. I am Flow Bike Senior Editor Ian Dilley.
And I am Michael Sheehan, Ian's friend. Today we are doing a preview special of the upcoming Classica San Sebastian.
Yes, this is sort of like stage 22 of the Tour de France. It comes only 5 days after the Tour de France ends. You've got most of the top contenders of the Tour de France in this race. And it's a full-on one-day classic, 137 miles, 13,000 feet of climbing in the Basque country of Spain. It's an exciting race. It's not maybe on par with Lombardia or Liège-Bastogne-Liège. It's only been around since 1981, so it doesn't have quite the cachet of these races that have been around for more than 100 years. But in terms of the difficulty of this race, the caliber of the contenders, it's going to be one of the top one-day races of the year.
Yeah, we are pretty much just launching back into an Ardennes classic type race. Only difference is it is in northern Spain. So you get the really, really punchy climbs, narrow roads, all the stuff we love about Vuelta País Vasco. It is just bundled up into a one-day brutal affair. It is a long, long day of racing.
Yeah, and just beautiful scenery also. San Sebastian is one of the most revered resort cities in the world, you know, right on the Bay of Biscay. These climbs like the Jaizkibel go, you know, right up on these ridges that overlook the ocean and just stunning scenery. So yeah, definitely really looking forward to this race. Let's talk about what we expect to see. Who are your picks for this race, Michael?
So contrary to what you would think, this race has actually been won, what, the last 10 years in a row by someone who is coming off the Tour de France. So it seems to really be about who is carrying this like flying Tour de France form, and they're not like not cracked, not tired. Some people are going to come off the Tour really well, and honestly, those are the people that we expect to see winning San Sebastian.
Yeah, and that totally blows my mind. How do you go for 3 weeks, you know, doing the hardest bike race in the world, you know, fly to Spain, 5 days later, you know, you're flying. I mean, maybe it's one of those things where it doesn't feel good, but they're still going just ridiculously fast. You know, I think even though the defending champion, Kwiatkowski, is not currently on the start list, Sky is going to be really hard to beat. You know, we saw that they were flying at the end of the tour. Jonathan Castrovejo was 14th in the time trial. Egan Bernal was still up there in 25th. So these guys still have a lot of juice left, even though they were riding the front of the Sky train for 3 weeks.
Yeah, I think it's going to be another really interesting test for the youngster, Egan Bernal. He just did his first Tour de France. He's super young, and they have him slated for yet another race. He performed phenomenally in the Tour. He was one of the last guys standing in the Sky train in the hardest mountain days, just day in, day out. Heck, why not? He very well could be their chosen guy for Classica San Sebastian. One person, though, who we just really can't rule out, it is a hilly race. It's in Spain. Alejandro Valverde.
Yeah, he's won this twice before. He's been on the podium 4 other times. Yeah, it's a race that's right up his alley. You know, it's in that Liège, Flèche Wallonne, short, punchy climbs. And he also has the Movistar team with him. You know, Mikel Landa was really the linchpin to Kwiatkowski's victory last year. You know, there's the final climb of the Alto de Mojil. It's a brutal ascent, you know, almost 12% in gradient over, you know, roughly 2K. Comes at mile 130 plus into the race. And, you know, last year Landa attacked on this climb, got away, and it was really Kwiatkowski sitting on the back of the chase that allowed him to take the sprint in the 5-man finale. So, you know, having that Landa-Valverde combination, and let's not forget that Landa is from the Basque region, and this is a cycling-mad region, so they're going to be extremely motivated.
Yeah, we are also looking at Julian Alaphilippe. He just won the KOM jersey at the Tour de France. He is obviously feeling very spry, really, really adept on these punchy climbs. He's going to be another favorite. Could notch up, I don't know how many victories Quickstep has this year, but you can't rule them out.
Yeah, I mean, he was phenomenal at the Tour. Seemed to be attacking at will. Seemingly took the King of the Mountains with ease, so I think all eyes are going to be on him. Adam Yates is also a former winner of San Sebastian, so certainly someone to watch. And then maybe not a favorite, but someone to watch is our good friend
Lawson Craddock. Yeah. I'm still kind of amazed that he's on the start list. He broke his scapula, what, first day of the tour?
First day of the Tour of France.
Rode all the way to Paris with a broken shoulder. He gets 5 days off and is back in a race. And honestly, this race is, I think it's a great, great course for Lawson. And I feel so bad for him, honestly, just because of broken shoulder throughout the entire tour. If he was on flying form and didn't get injured in the tour, he would probably be one of my favorites for the finale in San Sebastian. Right now, big question mark over him. I really have no idea what state his shoulder and his body is in, but can't rule him out. He has already just done phenomenal things over the last 3 weeks.
Yeah, and he's going to be motivated. I think this whole EF Education first team is going to be motivated because Rigoberto Urán is on the start list as well, or the preliminary start list for this race. You know, Urán was somebody that was a contender for the Tour de France, in great position through the first week, but that crash on the Roubaix stage really forced him out of the race. The injuries he sustained in that crash, he wasn't able to overcome during the mountain stages. So I think Urán is going to come to this race with some good form and a lot of motivation. I think the whole team is going to be motivated. So that'll be exciting to see.
Yeah, I agree. Urán was right up there at the finale and just kind of cracked a little bit on the last climb last year in San Sebastian. Maybe just taking the rest of the tour off, not being able to finish, will produce some better legs for him this year. Another person that we should touch on is Primož Roglič, who has shown himself phenomenally well, of course, in the Vuelta País Vasco. He's not a one-day racer, but after País Vasco, he also said he wasn't a three-week racer, and he kind of just proved that wrong in the Tour.
So
who knows what he's going to do. He's coming with a really, really incredibly strong Lotto NL Jumbo team between Robert Gesink, Steven Kruiswijk. Both those guys are going to be at the start of San Sebastian also, so I think that that's kind of a team that is going to have a lot of cards to play throughout this day of racing.
Yeah, he hasn't really proven himself as a one-day racer yet, but he was going toe-to-toe in these sort of one-day stages at the start of the Basque Country, which were very similar. You know, he lost a couple heads-up sprints to Alaphilippe, so yeah, could be payback for him. He's obviously riding phenomenally in the last week of the Tour. You know, my favorite thing about this race is there's always a little bit of a letdown after the Tour de France. You know, you spend 3 weeks fully invested, and it's like, you know, maybe it's not the racer's favorite thing to come back and do a 140-mile race 5 days later, but as a fan, it's great. I mean, we're going to have the top stars in the world doing a beautiful race. So only 5 days after the Tour, it's you get a little bit of relief from your Tour hangover.
Yeah, just love one-day races in general also. You don't have to wake up every morning and watch it. It's one and done. All the action is condensed. And we'll talk a little bit about the course. It starts off 27K in. There's a defined as a mellow gradual Cat 3 climb. My predictions are this field is going to let a little innocuous breakaway roll early and just slowly reel them in the second half of the race. Because keep in mind, it is a very long day, 230K. That being said, if there are hitters who are trying to set out early, it is going to be a really, really hard first 2 hours of racing. So depending on what the makeup of the breakaway is, it's really going to determine the day. Then 125K into the race, we really get into the meat of it. We have two ascents up the, Ian, correct me if I'm saying this wrong, the Heiskebel?
That's correct.
Two ascents of the Heiskebel. It's about an 8 kilometer long climb, averages about 8%, is that right? So they do some circuits up that, and the final climb is just murderous. We talked about it a second ago. 2 kilometers long, averages 12%, kicks up to 20-something?
Yeah, 22% at points. And this was an ascent that was really introduced only a couple of years ago. You know, they thought this course was too easy. I think there was like a bunch finish of over 20 riders at one point, so they introduced the Murheel, which has really made for exciting finales. You know, we've seen a group coming to, you know, a reduced group coming to the Murheel at the end of this race. And, you know, it's the exciting thing about this is there's also a tight technical descent off the Murheel. So it's going to make for a phenomenal race. And the other thing, too, that we've seen this year with the reduced teams, only 7 riders instead of 8 in the one-day races, it makes for more open racing. I mean, Amstel, Liège, we've seen finishes to these races that have gone from a longer ways out. So we could see an attack going from further out, making it all the way to the finish. So definitely keep your eyes on that. Things might change out a little bit different with the reduced team sizes.
Yeah, either way, it is going to be fireworks in the finale. And one more guy that we should mention, Greg Van Avermaet. He is the only kind of classic specialist who is going to be in the race. And yeah, if it isn't raced too hard for him, he could be very, very good in the finale. But these final climbs are just brutal.
Yeah, he's always done well in this race in the past, regularly top 10. So, and he was obviously riding well at the Tour. So it could be interesting to see if BMC and Greg Van Avermaet can factor in the finale of this. We'll find out on Saturday.
Yeah, please watch live on Flow Bikes. Thank you for joining.